you should report a measure of effect size whenever you report a statistical test. Let's learn how to create an effect size for a one-way ANOVA, both by hand and in SPSS. Why do we need to report an effect size when we already have a statistically significant hypothesis test? And the answer is the difference between statistical significance and practical significance. Because statistical significance is a function of sample size, as n increases, you will find statistical significance even for small and relatively meaningless differences. Big enough sample, everything will be statistically significantly different. And many of those differences won't really matter in the real world. Statistical significance means that the differences that you observed in the means in your test was unlikely to occur if the null hypothesis was true. If the groups were not different, as you surmised, you would not get these findings. But you did get these findings, so it is highly likely that the groups were different after all. And that is a statement of probability. Statistical significance tells us that differences we found were unlikely to have occurred by chance. Practical significance is a standardized measure of the difference between your sample and the null. It removes the influence of sample size. Practical significance means that the difference has clinical, real-world significance. It is a way of determining if statistically significant differences really matter in the real world. Now, there are two kinds of practical significance: strength of association and effect size. Strength of association is a measure of the percentage of variance in the dependent variable accounted for by the independent variable. In an ANOVA, that measurement is eta squared. Eta squared is equivalent to r squared and is interpreted in the same way. It explains the percentage of variance in the dependent variable accounted for by the independent variable. In our Munchkins example, 66% of the complaints about wicked witches were explained by the region in which the Munchkins lived. That's a lot. But eta squared tends to be biased in that it overestimates the true effect size. Therefore, the strength of association most commonly reported for an ANOVA is a partial eta squared. Partial eta squared is interpreted the same as r squared. It is still the percentage of variance in the dependent variable accounted for by the independent variable. However, partial eta squared is an unbiased correction to eta squared. When working by hand, partial eta squared can be calculated with the information in the ANOVA summary table. It is especially useful for repeated measures ANOVA and multiple factor designs, and it can be requested using the GLM1 model in SPSS. More about that in a moment. To calculate the partial eta squared strength of association, we need a formula. All of the elements that are going to go into this formula can be gleaned from the ANOVA summary table that we created when we finished our analysis. We would begin with the sum of squares between, which plugs in two places in the formula. We would then get the sum of squares within and plug it in. For the example with the Wizard of Oz, this would be 37.75 divided by the sum of 37.75 plus 19.20, which equals 0.663. That means that 66.3% of the variability in complaints about wicked witches is explained by the region in which the Munchkins live. Remember that 0.663 value, because we will see it again in SPSS. Now, there is one more measure of effect size that you may encounter with an ANOVA: omega squared. Omega squared is the standard effect size measurement for an ANOVA, and it can be calculated from the data available in the ANOVA summary table. It is also interpreted the same way as r squared. However, omega squared is an unbiased measure of effect size and, As such, it will always be smaller than partial eta squared, which will always be smaller than eta squared. Of the three, partial eta squared is the most widely reported. Omega squared is calculated using this formula. You can see that it is a little more complex than the partial eta squared formula, but everything that we need to calculate it can be found in the ANOVA summary table. We would begin with the sum of squares between, which plugs into the formula, minus the degrees of freedom between, times the mean square within, which also plugs in two places in the formula. Finally, we plug in the sum of squares total, and we have all of the numbers. This example uses the data from the previous video about the Wizard of Oz, but you can use the same procedure with any one-way ANOVA. In this case, omega squared equals 0.587. That means that 58.7% of the variability in complaints about wicked witches is explained by the region in which the Munchkins live. If you want to compute an effect size for ANOVA using SPSS, you will need to use a different set of drop-down menus to run the ANOVA than we used with the compare means command. This is the way that you would run an ANOVA, typically if you were doing it for real-world research. The first method that I showed you is easier for teaching because it contains only the information for the ANOVA and leaves out the rest of the general linear model, making the output easier to understand. However, the compare means approach does not have an option for partial eta squared. To conduct this analysis, using the wickedwitch.sav dataset, go to Analyze, General Linear Model, Univariate. Move Complaints to the Dependent Variable box, and then move Region to the Fixed Factors box. Now you can click on Options. Under Options, click on Estimates of Effect Size. You may notice others of these options are the same as the one-way ANOVA that we did with the Explore Means command. You could do your ANOVA with this set of commands instead. Plus, it gives you more options. So now click on Continue and OK. This is the same output as we got using the Compare Means command, but with a lot more detail. In the output, you will find the partial eta squared value, 0.663, in the last column for the row region. Same value that we got calculating by hand. That means that 66.3% of the variability in complaints about wicked witches was explained by the region in which the Munchkins lived.